As a practitioner, you may implement multiple countermeasures at a single location, such as adding pavement markings, widening shoulders, or adding rumble strips. But what is the combined safety effect of applying multiple countermeasures? It makes sense that additional improvements would provide an added safety benefit beyond that of the first countermeasure. But how much more? Would you expect the same safety benefit from the second countermeasure as if it was installed by itself? What about the third? Ideally, a crash modification factor, or CMF, would be available that represents the effect of combined countermeasures. If so, it is relatively easy to use a single CMF to estimate the change in crashes. More than likely, however, you will need to use multiple CMFs and select an appropriate method to estimate the combined effect. Welcome to part 2 of FHWA's instructional video on analyzing the combined effect of multiple countermeasures. This video describes the process of applying an appropriate method to estimate the combined effect when you need to use multiple CMFs. Part 1 focused on the selection of an appropriate method. This video assumes you are familiar with the general concepts of selecting and applying standalone CMFs. You can refer to FHWA's CMF Clearinghouse and other resources on the webpage at the end of this video for further guidance on selecting and applying CMFs. While these videos focus on scenarios with two countermeasures, there is the potential to apply these concepts to three or more measures. Part 1 of this two-part series introduced four potential methods: the multiplicative method, the additive method, the dominant effect method, and the dominant common residuals method. In this video, you will learn how to use each of the four methods to estimate the combined effect of multiple countermeasures. You will also learn how to apply the results from the methods for two general scenarios. 1, when the individual CMFs apply to the same crash type and severity. And 2, when the individual CMFs apply to different crash types or severities. You may complete this video from start to finish, or skip directly to the method or application of interest. The multiplicative method is appropriate for scenarios where one or more CMFs are greater than 1. If both CMFs are less than or equal to 1, then one of the other methods is more appropriate. Using the multiplicative method, you simply multiply the two CMFs as shown in the equation, where CMF1 and CMF2 are the applicable CMFs for the individual countermeasures, and CMFT represents the combined effect of the two countermeasures. For example, if CMF1 is 0.80 and CMF2 is 1.10, then CMFT is 0.88. The additive method is appropriate for scenarios where there is no overlap expected among the countermeasure effects or where there is an expected enhancing effect among the countermeasures. Using the additive method, you simply add the two effects as shown in the equation, where CMF1 and CMF2 are the applicable CMFs for the individual countermeasures, and CMFT represents the combined effect of the two countermeasures. Note that you do not add the CMFs. Further, there is a need to confirm that the combined effect does not exceed 100%. If it does, then assume a maximum reduction of 100%. For example, if CMF1 is 0.80 and CMF2 is 0.95, then CMFT is 0.75. The dominant effect method only considers the effect of the countermeasure with the smallest CMF. This method is appropriate for scenarios where there is complete overlap expected among the countermeasure effects. Using the dominant effect method, you simply apply the smallest CMF, ignoring the effect of the other, as shown in the equation. In this case, CMF1 is the applicable CMF for the individual countermeasure with the smallest CMF value, and CMFT represents the combined effect of the two countermeasures. For example, if CMF1 is 0.80 and CMF2 is 0.95, then CMFT is 0.80, which is the smallest CMF and the greatest effect. The dominant common residuals method considers the effect of both countermeasures but reduces the effectiveness of the second countermeasure. This method is appropriate for scenarios where there is some overlap expected among the countermeasure effects. The dominant common residuals method is similar to the multiplicative method, except the result is raised to the power of the smallest CMF, as shown in the equation. This provides a more conservative estimate of the combined effect than the multiplicative method. In this case, CMF1 is the applicable CMF for the individual countermeasure with the smallest CMF value. CMF2 is the applicable CMF for the individual countermeasure with the second smallest CMF value. And CMFT represents the combined effect of the two countermeasures. For example, if CMF1 is 0.80 and CMF2 is 0.90, then CMFT is 0.77. When the individual CMFs apply to the same crash type and severity, the application of the results from the previous methods is relatively straightforward. Specifically, you would apply the CMF that represents the combined countermeasure effect, CMFT, to the estimated number of applicable crashes without treatment. Refer to the resources on the webpage at the end of this video for further guidance on how to estimate the number of crashes without treatment. As an example, consider a scenario where you would like to estimate the combined effect of two countermeasures, centerline and shoulder rumble strips. You have selected these countermeasures to address safety concerns related to head-on and run-off-the-road crashes along a rural two-lane road. This table presents the values and applicability of the CMFs for the individual countermeasures. Following the steps in the companion video, you determine the CMF values, potential overlap, magnitude of effects, and applicability of CMFs, as summarized here. Both CMFs are less than 1. There is some potential overlap in the countermeasure effects. The magnitude of the effects are small and medium, and the CMFs apply to the same crash types and severities. The next step is to select and apply an appropriate method to estimate the combined effect of the countermeasures. Based on these considerations and the process described in the companion video, either the dominant effect or dominant common residuals method is appropriate, whichever produces the greatest reduction. Recall that CMF1 is the smallest CMF, 0.844, and CMF2 is the second smallest CMF, 0.912. The dominant effect method simply assumes the CMF with the smallest value, 0.844. This equation shows the application of the dominant common residuals method, which results in a combined effect of 0.802. In this case, the dominant common residuals method produces the greatest reduction and is used as the estimate of the combined effect. The CMF for the combined effect is applicable to run-off-the-road, head-on, and sideswipe crashes on urban and rural, two-lane, undivided roads because these were the applicable conditions for both individual CMFs. When the individual CMFs apply to different crash types or severities, it is necessary to apply the CMFs individually to the respective crashes and aggregate the results, rather than combine the CMFs. This figure provides an illustration of two CMFs that apply to different crash types or severities, shown here as crash groups. As shown in this figure, CMF1 applies to crash group 1, and CMF2 applies to crash group 2. As discussed in the companion video, you need to follow this 5-step process when the CMFs apply to different crash types or severities. Apply the smallest CMF to applicable crashes, excluding those crashes associated with other CMFs in the analysis. Apply the next smallest CMF to applicable crashes, excluding those crashes associated with other CMFs in the analysis. Estimate the CMF for the combined countermeasure effect and apply it to the applicable crashes. The applicable crashes would be those common to both CMFs. Sum the estimated change in crashes to calculate the combined effect. Check that estimated change does not exceed 100%. If it does, then assume a maximum reduction of 100%. If there are no applicable crashes common to both CMFs, then you can assume the full effect of both countermeasures and skip step 3. In this example, CMF1 is exclusively applicable to crash group 1 and crash group 2. So you would apply CMF1 to crash group 1 and crash group 2. CMF2 is exclusively applicable to crash group 3, so you would apply CMF2 to crash group 3. Finally, you would sum the estimated change in crashes to calculate the combined effect and check that the estimated change does not exceed 100%. If the CMFs are applicable to one or more of the same crash groups, then you need to apply all five steps. In this example, you would apply CMF 1 to crash group 1, CMF 2 to crash group 2. The question is, which CMF to apply for crash group 3? For the answer, you would apply the same process as before when the CMFs apply to the same crash type and severity and apply the resulting CMF to crash group 3. As discussed in the companion video, follow these rules when two or more CMFs are applicable to the same crash types or severities and apply the results to those crash types or severities. If one or more CMFs are greater than one, combine CMF1 and CMF2 using the multiplicative method. If there is complete overlap in countermeasure effects, use the dominant effect method to select the smallest CMF. If there is some overlap in countermeasure effects, estimate the combined effect using both the dominant effect and dominant common residuals methods and select the result that represents the greatest effect. As an example, consider an urban four-legged signalized intersection. Let's assume you identified left turn, rear end, and pedestrian crashes as concerns at this location. The two countermeasures of interest are installing left turn lanes on the major road approaches and installing a marked crosswalk on all four approaches. The total estimated crashes per year without treatment at this location include 3.5 left turn crashes, 4.5 rear end crashes, and 1.0 pedestrian crashes. There are no other crash types estimated at this location. The CMF for installing left turn lanes on the major road approaches is 0.81, which applies to total crashes. The CMF for installing a marked crosswalk on all four approaches is 0.60, which applies to pedestrian crashes only. Note that pedestrian crashes are a subset of total crashes. CMF1 represents the CMF with the smallest value. Install marked crosswalks. And CMF2 represents the CMF with the second smallest value. Install left turn lane on major road approaches. Using the five-step process, you would first apply CMF1 to the applicable crashes, excluding those crashes associated with other CMFs in the analysis. In this case, CMF1 is applicable to pedestrian crashes, but pedestrian crashes are also applicable to CMF2, since the CMF for installing left turn lanes applies to total crashes. Because the pedestrian crashes are a subset of total crashes, there are no applicable crashes to which you would apply CMF1 directly. For completeness, this equation shows the application of CMF1 to the number of applicable crashes for installing crosswalks. Next, apply CMF2 to the applicable crashes, excluding those crashes applicable to other CMFs in the analysis. In this case, there are 3.5 left-turn crashes and 4.5 rear-end crashes that are not applicable to the CMF for installing crosswalks, the non-pedestrian crashes. This equation shows the application of CMF2 to the applicable crashes. Since both CMFs are applicable to pedestrian crashes, there is a need to estimate the CMF to represent the combined effect and apply it to the pedestrian crashes, which are the applicable crashes common to both CMFs. Following the steps in the companion video, you determine the CMF values, potential overlap, and magnitude of effects as summarized here. Both CMFs are less than 1.0. There is some potential overlap in the countermeasure effects, and the magnitude of the effects are small and medium. Based on these considerations and the process described in the companion video, either the dominant effect or dominant common residuals method is appropriate, whichever produces the greatest reduction. Recall that CMF1 is the smallest CMF, 0.60, and CMF2 is the second smallest CMF, 0.81. The dominant effect method simply assumes the CMF with the smallest value, 0.60. This equation shows the application of the dominant common residuals method, which results in a combined effect of 0.65. In this case, the dominant effect method produces the greatest reduction and is used as the estimate of the combined effect. The CMF for the combined effect is applicable to the pedestrian crashes because these were the applicable crashes common to both individual CMFs. This equation shows the application of CMFT to the applicable crashes. Next, sum the change in crashes across the crash categories to estimate the combined effect. This table shows the estimated crashes without treatment, estimated crashes with treatment, and change in crashes for each crash group based on the previous calculations. In total, the estimated crashes without treatment is 9.0 per year. The estimated crashes with treatment is 7.08 per year. And the estimated change is a reduction of nearly 2.0 crashes per year. In this example, there were no crashes exclusively applicable to CMF1 for installing crosswalks because the applicable pedestrian crashes were also included in total crashes. As such, the benefit of the crosswalk is captured in the combined effect of both countermeasures on pedestrian crashes. Finally, check to make sure the estimated crash reduction does not exceed 100%. There is a total of 9.0 estimated crashes per year without treatment and 7.08 crashes per year with treatment, or a reduction of approximately 2 crashes per year with the treatments. So the estimated crash reduction does not exceed 100%. This video demonstrated how to apply 4 methods to estimate the combined effect of multiple countermeasures. Refer to the companion video for guidance on how to select the appropriate method. All the resources mentioned in this video can be found here, including the video for Part 1, Selecting a Method to Analyze Multiple Countermeasures. At the Federal Highway Administration, safety is our top priority. For more information, visit us online at safety.fhwa.dot.gov.